Just a quick introduction. My name is Eric Martinez, and I am co-president of the Westside Alumni Network. And so the purpose of this fireside chat today is not only to just connect alumni, but we've been really working hard to transform our in-person events to virtual. So thank you for taking the time to join us today. And for those who will listen afterwards, there will be a follow-up email with a couple of links that we'll talk about today, including one for our upcoming event. We will be having a home buyers panel on Thursday, July 2nd at 1 p.m. And so this will be a panel to hear from a realtor, home flipper, loan consultant, and an investment advisor to learn the basics to home buying. Two of our board members will be facilitating that. And the link will be in the follow-up email. So I invite those who are on the call and those who chime in a little bit later to type any questions in the Q&A section at the bottom. And I will try to throw them in our conversation. And if not, we'll just afterwards have a Q&A. Before we get started, I did want to make a quick note that this discussion is not medical advice, but a history of the 1918 flu. And so for more coronavirus information, I invite you to visit www.uclahealth.org/coronavirus. And now, without further ado, I will introduce you to Dr. William Purdy, who is a graduate and lecturer at the Graduate School of Education and Information Studies at UCLA. His research centers on the history of higher education, especially in Western United States, higher education and the law, and higher education policy analysis, especially concerning financial aid. He received his PhD in education from UCLA in 2016 and earned his JD from Florida State University in 2000. Dr. Purdy, thank you for joining us today on the call.
Thanks, Eric. Thanks for having me.
Cool, perfect. And so before we begin, can you just quickly share with us as to why you call this the 1918 flu rather than the Spanish flu?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's there's an advantage to calling this event, this epical historical event, the Spanish flu, because that's it quickly entered into common usage at the time and held onto that name in the public consciousness. But the problem is that it's a slam on Spain unnecessarily. During the First World War, we were still in it in 1918, and all of the combatant powers were ruthlessly censoring their national press. And so the flu was running through Europe and running through the combatant armies all through the year 1918, especially the summer and into the fall. But the newspapers for France and Great Britain and Germany, for example, weren't reporting on it at all, but Spain was a non-combatant and a neutral nation. So the Spanish newspapers were reporting on it faithfully and honestly, and so they got unfairly tagged with this being a Spanish flu because it was being acknowledged in an uncensored press, and it picked up that moniker accordingly around the world. And I don't need to point out for the audience that this has some, you know, unsavory parallels to today with the current administration referring often to, or at least at the beginning stages of COVID-19, of, you know, a Chinese plague or a Chinese flu or Chinese this or that. It has unsavory echoes to the Spanish flu thing. So most historians call it the 1918 flu, even if it's not as elegant of a term.
No, thank you. I think it's pretty straightforward. So tell me a little bit about what was going on in 1918 in higher education in America, and why did the 1918 flu receive little attention in higher ed textbooks?
You know, I'm really glad that you highlighted 1918. You know, we can't look at the 1918 flu through 2020 glasses. We have to like see things as they were that year. And higher education, you know, college campuses, university campuses, all the alums on this call, if you've been on campus tours of UCLA there in Westwood, you know that the campuses are built to look as if they've been there forever and they're gonna be there forever. So Westwood, all of our buildings are meant to look like, even though they were built not that long ago, not even 100 years ago, they're meant to look like they last. But the thing is, the history of American education is one where campuses have often felt quite nervous or anxious that their business is about to go under at any second, and that colleges and the business of higher education might just go belly up. So in 1918, there were real problems on college campuses because for the most part, 55% to 60% of college-going populations at the time were male. And all these guys were going off to the war in France, leaving college campuses relatively empty. And so colleges were having a hard time paying their bills, and they were worried they might have to shut down because of lack of attendance. And so into this like pressure-filled, anxious environment on college campuses came the opportunity from the federal government, the United States federal government, to build and operate barracks on college campuses. And this led to the Student Army Training Corps. So 500 colleges and universities, they basically built military army bases or Navy bases on their campuses with the benefit of having like bodies on campus to educate. But what they did was they opened a can of worms, and the military structures, the military leaders came into conflict with campus leaders that fall of 1918. And a lot of these conflicts led to greater deaths from the flu. So 1918 is a particularly perilous moment for the world in general, but specifically for American higher education and, you know, university presidents who are a little freaked out.
I'm sure, yeah. And I know you mentioned the role of the federal government. So what was the relationship between professors, institution, and students then?
Well, we're moving from a time, and if you take the history of higher education class at the Ed School, we're really big on this point. We're moving from the 1800s, the small liberal arts college, the birth of the American public high school, the large American public high school, especially in the Midwestern states. We're getting all these new public high school graduates, and they all, a good chunk of them, want to go to college for the first time. So the colleges and universities at the public level, think of the Big Ten schools or the Pac-10 schools, these big beefy public universities, they're, you know, rolling right along. So we're moving from this idea that, you know, a liberal arts college, the best way to run it is a professor at one end of the log and a student at the other end of the log, you know, chatting about the world. We're moving into like a different, more industrial university that's filling the needs of a modernizing workplace. That's becoming much more corporate, starting to resemble corporate America. And professors are making a lot more money. They've got a lot more bargaining power. They're becoming a little bit more imperial. So they're not as close to students, perhaps, in the early 20th century as they have been in the past. So it's almost like an arm's length transaction, a lot of the college classes. You know, the August kind of distant professor with a monocle, maybe he studied in Germany, right? And the sea of undergraduates who, you know, they're in college for lots of reasons, and most of them are social and economic, to get a good career and to make friends.
Okay, that's interesting, yeah. And I know you mentioned that the Student Army Training Corps, or SATC units, played a big role for universities during this time. And so because of that, what decisions did colleges have to make as the 1918, you know, flu was rolling out, and how were they able to remain open?
Yeah, I mean, here's where the echoes are strongest between 2020 and 1918, because you've got all of these university presidents, and they're in good touch with each other. This isn't the dark ages, right? I mean, people, every university president, all the major deans, they've got phones in their offices, you know, they've got telegraph offices on campus. You know, it's not instantaneous communication like we're experiencing right now, but it's pretty close. Pick up the phone and say, hey, how's it going in Boston today? Oh, it's a mess. Maybe don't open up Stanford, and back and forth. And there's also like a lot of letter writing going on too. So communication's pretty good among campus leaders. And they all see the flu happen kind of in real time, first on the East Coast, and then with a bit of a delay on the West Coast, because as soldiers and sailors moved from the East Coast back from Europe out to the coast, they brought the flu with them. So the East Coast really starts to see the flu take hold in September, the West Coast in October, especially at UCLA, or I'm sorry, the Normal School in late October. But on the East Coast, you know, Harvard's President Lowell, he says, I've got the quotation here, and I don't want to be the boring professor and just read from my book, right? But he says, listen, if we close down Harvard, we're going to cause a panic among all these other universities and colleges. It's up to us to stay open and keep things going. So he's very cognizant of the idea that Harvard's a leader. So even though Boston College doesn't open until mid-October, Harvard pushes ahead, Dartmouth pushes ahead, all these places push ahead, and it's not in the face of public health admonitions, but it is with this sense that they've got a responsibility to keep higher ed going. It's a heavy responsibility borne by these prestigious schools. So every college and university had to decide, are we going to open or not? And then if we open, what measures are we going to take to protect our student body? Very similar to the decisions that everybody's making this summer. You know, the vice chancellor just sent out an email yesterday about UCLA that we're going to have 15 to 20% of our classes, you know, hybrid or in-person and the rest online. You know, everybody's making this balancing test. Like, how do we express leadership? What can we get away with? How do we protect our students? It's harrowing.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mentioned that. I was listening to the podcast regarding higher education and 1918 flu, and I know a lot of universities had different responses. Harvard, you know, had to put its image up to kind of move forward and keep things going as normal as can be. But other universities, like you mentioned, closed down or just, you know, altered their classes. So with that, if you could just talk a little bit more about this theory of public health elitism and how that played a role on college campuses during the time.
Yeah, you know, theory is not just for graduate seminars, right? It actually, if you find the right ones, boy, it can really explain real world phenomena. And historians are like, have the reputation for being rather allergic to theory. But public health elitism says that, hey, you know, when it comes to major public health crises, pandemics, epidemics, the public follows the leadership of its experts. At least modern societies. And our public health experts in the 1918 flu were public health officers, faculty at universities, and they were giving advice to governors and mayors and campus leaders and military officers. And for the most part, that advice was followed pretty carefully. So even though we're a small D democracy and decisions are meant to be made, you know, for and by the people. And when it comes to these public health crises, we do tend to follow a small group of elites, and they are bodily represented in 1918 and today by public health officers, whether it's Barbara Ferrer today in LA County, or the public health officers for various metropolitan areas and states in 1918. We follow their advice.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like, you know, California was really following the advice of Berkeley, but as you mentioned beforehand, talking before this, Berkeley was hit pretty hard, and I believe they had a failed vaccine. Can you talk about how that how this affected the trajectory of UCLA as the Los Angeles State Normal School at the time?
Absolutely. Berkeley is affected by the flu before the normal school, simply because soldiers make it to Berkeley before they do all the other campuses from the East Coast. Remember that Berkeley is the only UC campus, and it also encompassed the San Francisco Medical Campus even then. The 1905 earthquake's the place to look for how Berkeley developed its medical and public health apparatus, because the nurses being trained at Berkeley were major contributors to the efforts to dig out from under the rubble of that earthquake. Now in 1918, you know, Berkeley's in the forefront again as a research institution. Remember, the UC's mission is teaching, research, service, not necessarily in that order. And so Berkeley's got this research agenda, and they tried really hard to come up with a vaccine fast for the flu. Of course, they weren't able to get one together. We didn't get an influenza vaccine until the 1930s, but yet they had that mission to serve the public by finding a vaccine. And the normal school, you know, it's purely to train school teachers in San Jose and LA campuses and the San Diego campus. And so, you know, UCLA, the State Normal School, always felt less than, because, you know, it's, you know, the professors that were teaching at the normal school, they wanted that research mission too. They wanted the ability to serve the public the way Berkeley was doing. And they were desperate for it. All through 1918, Edward Dixon, the only regent on the UC Regents from Southern California, was just pressing for a full UC branch campus in LA. And finally, we got it.
Yeah. It kind of sounds to me that this 1918 flu served as a catalyst to, you know, transition the normal school into UCLA, what it is today, and make it a research-leading university. But at the time, you know, oh yeah.
Yeah, Eric, I definitely think it did, Eric. You know, crises breed opportunities. And Ernest Carroll Moore was able to show that not only could he like come up against the military and hold his own, but that he could weather various crises, not as just the head of a normal school, but in a way that was like, that seemed to suggest that he would do really well leading a branch campus as well. Also, the people of Los Angeles, you know, what came first, the chicken or the egg? The need for a public university campus in LA, or the driving ambition and just thirst of the people of LA for everything that a big city's supposed to have? And coming out of the flu pandemic, all you saw in the papers were comparisons between how LA responded to the flu and how San Francisco responded to the flu. It's LA versus San Francisco, such a rivalry. And so coming out of these like multiple crises, the people of LA were screaming for their own university, and they were going to have it, whether it was a private campus, which we were threatening, or whether it was going to be a branch campus. But the flu had a big part to play in that.
Yeah. And like you mentioned, not only the flu, but also the military, you know, the federal government's role in these universities. So specifically to UCLA, can you talk about more about the SATC unit's role there?
Yeah, it's pretty fascinating. You know, there's SATC units, the Student Army Training Corps. It's meant to be like, you know, they honed this for the Second World War, where it's really hard to just, boom, come up with a trained army overnight for whatever we need it for like a worldwide conflict. It has to happen in stages. And in the Second World War, they took like the small professional army, and they used that professional army to train a civilian army, just like they'd done, the Union Army had done in the Civil War. Well, in the First World War, they were like, oh my God, how do we do this? They're making it up for the first time, right? And so they came up with a very flawed plan of let's have army barracks and train soldiers to go to France. But while they're waiting to embark, basically, to go to France, why don't we have them like keep going to college? But we pulled them out of regular college dorms and experiences and put them separately into military barracks on campuses. So it was like, you can't combine a military life and a civilian college life in the ways that they were doing it, the Student Army Training Corps. So it was a failure. Colleges saw it as a total failure. Now, the state normal school, you could not apply for a Student Army Training Corps camp barracks or program unless you had at least 100 male students enrolled the previous semester. The San Diego Normal School didn't have that. It was all women students, pretty much. And the LA State Normal School was nearly all women, but they had just enough male students to qualify for a SATC unit. And that was tremendously prestigious to Ernest Carroll Moore and all the State Normal School people, because having more male students meant more prestige, male-dominated majors like business, economics, geography, the sciences, mathematics, everything, right? They needed male students for the prestige that came with it in a, you know, biased world of 1918. And so the State Normal School got that campus. They got the SATC designation. And so that's like a step on the road to being a full campus. Look, we're not just a school teacher training facility that's all women students. We're something else. We're like a real university. That's what the SATC imprimatur gave the normal school. But then what happened is there were tremendous conflicts between the civilian leadership and the military. And when the flu hits the normal school campus at the end of October, like a ton of bricks, there aren't any doctors. They're all downtown in LA. And so the State Normal School is like, oh my God, people are dying on campus. Soldiers are dying on campus. And we've got a doctor. She graduated from Hopkins in 1908, Dr. Lillian Ray, only she's a woman. She's the leading physician at the State Normal School because it's mostly a female student body. And she's like, hey, get me in there. I'll treat all these guys. And the Army would not let her in the barracks to treat sick soldiers. They said, let's wait for a contract male physician from downtown. And they waited and they waited and nobody came. So finally they let Dr. Ray in with a bunch of volunteers, a a bunch of volunteer nurses from the student body at the State Normal School, women students, came in and helped her, and they saved tons of lives, according to Ernest Carroll Moore's memoirs. So, oh, there's just a tremendous number of conflicts that arise from the normal school getting this SATC unit.
And it sounds like gender played a big role to it. I know you mentioned Dr. Lillian Ray, who was allowed, you know, finally to treat these sick individuals. How else did gender play a role, you know, during this time?
Well, the enrollments at the State Normal School, and this fella, James Anderson's written a book on the LA State Normal School, and you can catch it online. I think it's UCLA1881.org. And his argument has always been, hey, we should have been promoting UCLA's birth date as 1881, not 1919, because that's when the normal school started. And, you know, reasonable minds may differ, right? It's a pretty good argument. He wrote a separate history on the State Normal School, and I recommend, if anybody's interested, to go into it further. But the point is, with respect to gender, at the beginning of UCLA's history, it's nearly all women students, because we're going from the State Normal School directly into life as a university branch campus. But then, throughout the 1920s and definitely through the 1930s, we go from like 75% women enrollments in 1919 down to like less than half by World War II. Because all of these majors are added one after the other to the catalog, and they're male-dominated majors, so the proportion of women students drops. But that's not to say that women were just studying to become nurses or school teachers or doing home ec. Not at all. They were entering these other male-dominated majors and pushing to get in, pushing really hard. They just weren't able to do so in large numbers because of the biases at the time. But the story of women students at UCLA in the 20s and 30s is a really, really fascinating one. And it starts with the State Normal School, but it doesn't end there. It becomes something much more different and weird and interesting.
Yeah, I'm sure. And so we talked a little bit about gender, but did race play a role in the 1918 flu? And what can you tell me about that?
This is a sources issue that the historian has to face, right? All of the major newspapers of the time are directed toward white audiences. So the LA Times, like, you know, it doesn't mention the African-American population of LA much. It's a conservative paper too. It's catering to a mostly white audience. So you got to read the Eagle, and you have to read also the Chicago Recorder and the Philadelphia Bulletin and some other newspapers that like report specifically on African-American issues. But Alfred Crosby wrote the first history on the flu, the 1918 flu. He wrote the first major history on it in 1976. Nobody touched the subject really for 50, 60 years. So when he wrote about it in the 1970s, Crosby said that while certain populations like American Indians died, had a 9% mortality rate, African-American populations fared about the same as white populations. That was in 1976. But I think the research has borne out in the past 40 years that in the major cities especially, deaths of African-Americans were vastly underreported, and they suffered terribly in the 1918 flu. There's a paper or an article that needs to be written about African-American enrollments at the State Normal School, like 1881 to 1918, because the research isn't there. But there were African-American students, African-American women students, African-American men students at the LA State Normal School in 1918. Not that many, but definitely, you know, 5 to 10. And their stories aren't there for us to study right this second, but their stories are waiting to be told. The thing about UCLA is it's de jure, by law, open to everybody in 1918, the State Normal School and then UCLA in 1919. So by law, it's you know, integrated racially. But in fact, there are all of these factors that are restricting entry to the State Normal School and to UCLA based on your race. These are major factors. You know, redlined residential districts, not having access. Students of color didn't have access to the major feeder schools, the public high schools that were going to UCLA. High school counselors discourage students of color from even thinking about higher ed. So there's all of these like factors that combined to keep enrollments at UCLA and the state normal school really low for students of color, especially African Americans. But that said, low enrollments, that doesn't mean no enrollments. So in my dissertation and the research, it's not just me, but there's research really developing in the 20s and 30s. It's really important for us to look at the history of African-American students at UCLA in the 1920s, because even though it wasn't a high number of students, their experiences really echo today. And there's tremendous parallels between student populations in the 20s and student populations in the 2020s. And I really encourage people to dig in there.
Yeah. And you mentioned this happening at UCLA, but I'm sure, you know, this was kind of just echoing across universities, you know, around America with low enrollment and all these, you know, challenging obstacles to get into a university. It sounds like, you know, through this conversation, the space sharing experiment between the military and universities wasn't as helpful as I think they thought it would be, especially fighting the flu. So what happened to the SATC units afterward and the relationship between military and educational leadership?
Yeah, well, I mean, some historical parallels, you know, at some point the parallels aren't as useful. So the 1918 flu isn't as useful to 2020 in some ways. So, you know, the flu kind of blew through town. It was super like morbid and exacted a high death toll. From September through December and January of 1919. So it was like a few months of like lots of deaths, and then it kind of went away. I mean, there was another wave worldwide a little bit in 1919, 1920, but nothing like what had come in 1918 and 1919. So, you know, the war ends on the 11th day, the 11th month at the 11th hour in 1918, and then all the SAT units are disbanded by January 1919, and it's like all the ghosts leave campus. There's nothing left. Most of the structures were temporary. They're taken down. There's hardly any archival evidence of the existence of these units on a lot of campuses. You know, the normal school's newspaper wasn't even published in the fall of 1918 because the campus was closed to everybody but soldiers. So like it's like it never happened. And people think it's crazy for me to say that. But in 1919, if you read newspapers, yearbooks, books, everybody just wanted to forget about the war, about the SATC, about the flu, about everything. They just wanted it in their past. And that's why, you know, Scott Fitzgerald sits down and starts writing all these books about like people that are just making up their past or trying to run away from their past, because that's what was happening nationally. Just like, oh, didn't even happen.
I'm sure, yeah. I mean, I could see a lot today of people, you know, just trying to go out and just continue to life like normal as if, you know, the pandemic is over, but it is still happening. And let's see, you mentioned, you know, these waves of the 1918 flu, but I believe the biggest wave happened before the war ended, because once the war ended, SATC, you know, units didn't have to travel, therefore not spreading the virus. Is that correct? Or can you share more about that?
Yeah, like a lot of the quarantines, for example, the normal school's quarantine, and lots of other schools too, went up to November 7th, and then it was relaxed. So there's a mythology. It's actually maybe not a mythology. There's a story that's borne out by historical evidence that on Armistice Day, which is now Veterans Day, November 11th, everybody poured into the streets and partied hard because the war was over. And yeah, that happened. That happened. And like, so there was a second wave of the flu that washed through the major cities because of these celebrations. But I really want the audience to like, you know, be careful about drawing conclusions. Like the 1918, the flu being transmitted, H1N1 flu being transmitted by major celebrations is somehow like historical evidence, like that would argue against mass protests and rallies today, because they're not the same thing, not the same affliction, not the same populations, 100 years apart. And we're starting to see data come back based on, you know, COVID-19 transmission rates 2 weeks after like major protests and rallies, and we're seeing that it's like not adding much of a spike. But that's not about the 1918 flu. But I just want the audience to be very cautious about seeing something that happened in 1918 that we think caused a spike or second wave of the 1918 flu, and taking that as like evidence that that would happen today too. We just don't know. Also, I want to point out that the H1N1 flu, which will come back, it came back in 2009, it circulates the population still, and we'll get it again at some point. This thing's a toughie. It's a toughie. It's different from than COVID. You know, COVID has a U curve, you know? But like,
it's older generations.
And I can't get the chalkboard out, right? But let's just say COVID, for the most part, is really slamming elderly population. So, you know, if you're over 70 or over 65, you're going to probably show more symptoms than a younger person. You got more chance to be hospitalized. If you're hospitalized, more chance of dying, all these things, right? But the H1N1 flu in 1918, it was rough because it followed a W curve. So there's this spike in the curve. And people from like 25 to 44 or 20 to 44, they died in disproportionate numbers. So it was a very scary thing to see people in the bloom of health, in the flower of youth, cut down by this flu, and it happened. And so it made it very scary. And so it affected different populations than today's COVID-19. So the elderly people in 1918, not as high of a percentage of the population in 1918 as today, they were relatively scot-free. Why? Well, we think that an early version of H1N1 swept through the population decades before, when the elderly population in 19 were children, and they built up immunities. So in 1918, their bodies were just like, yeah, this doesn't bother us at all. And then the young, or the relatively young, just took it on the chin.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. So how did this experience help universities shape their social obligations, institutional missions, and physical boundaries of higher education?
Well, I really think that I want to restrict my comments to public universities. Even though I talked about Lowell and Harvard and how Harvard felt like it had a mission to lead, et cetera, but the story, the main drivers of the growth of American higher education in the 20s, 30s, 40s, et cetera, it's the state universities, right? The big publics. And there was already this idea in California, the California idea of public higher education and the Wisconsin idea of higher education, hugely important ideas. The idea that like you've got this three-part mission, research, teaching, service, and you know, Professor whoever you are, Professor X, you know, your primary duty, Professor X, is to the state, is to the people. And your work should always be relevant to the Commonwealth as much as possible. And so this idea was already developing with agricultural research, especially in the late 1800s and in the early 1900s, you know, building the best tangerine you can in Southern California, right? We were just talking about the Riverside Citrus Experiment Station that was built in 1907 that became UC Riverside. But the flu really crystallized people's visions about this, that we're supposed to be in service to the community, not enthralled to the federal government, meaning, oh, please build barracks on our campuses and walk all over us, but in service to our communities, our state citizens. And it really, it tied university campuses to their people even closer than they were before. So in Minnesota, people were dying left and right on campus in 1918. The flu took a horrific toll there, but there something good that came out of it was the University Health Service, which was kind of the first real major public health operation in one of these Big Ten schools. And it served as a model for the rest of the country. So we're not just treating students and their public health problems, but we're also treating the public health problems of the citizens of the state.
Yeah. I know you talked about how this really did help a lot of universities kind of align their missions with research, education, and service. And so how did this, what did UCLA learn from this experience regarding their identity, academic relations, et cetera?
Well, first thing was the army was not allowed back on campus. You know, no barracks on campus anymore. And while the university leadership had a good relationship with the military for sure, like they never forgot that inviting a parallel power structure onto campus is a bad thing for a university. Now, when you want to talk about echoes through history, universities had to like swallow this one down again in the 1960s. UCLA invited the LAPD on campus a couple times, most importantly on May 5th, 1970. And so whenever you have parallel power structures on a university campus, there's a problem that the university mission is going to be compromised by whatever mission is being exercised by that parallel power structure. So even if there's not the army on campus anymore, UCLA did have to face this problem later on with having the police on campus, and also had to face the, you know, less than goodwill, for example, of a Governor Ronald Reagan, who was tired of unrest on campus, you know, and wanted the campuses controlled. So the university was always able to look back to 1918 and say, we've got to carefully define our campus borders and keep them sacrosanct and make sure that the university's leadership is followed within this space. And we've done it ever since, with some, you know, notable exceptions. But the university is jealous of its authority on its physical campus.
Yeah. It's interesting that you mentioned that. I'm just thinking of all the ongoing discussions right now with UCLA and with everything going on. And so you kind of mentioned beforehand, you know, you say that history doesn't necessarily repeat itself, but it can rhyme. So what can we learn or apply in our current situation to you know, the 1918 experience?
Well, I think that, you know, public health crises and pandemics expose a fissure in society, like a major tension. You know, professors love talking about tensions, right? And for good reason. There's this tension between our belief that universities can, you know, be democratizing institutions that can really be pillars of support for our small d democracy and help the people, all of the people, right? Even if they don't attend the university. And so there's this like mass appeal of the university to all the people. But then there's this other strain of public health elitism, meaning that there's no way that the vast percentage of the population can understand the absolutely difficult medical concepts being grappled with by our public health experts. And to some degree, we have to defer to the public health experts to tell us and help us craft best practices. So there's this terrific like tug of war, and that's not the right word, because it's not a war. There's just a tension between elites, experts trying to like drive forward a useful, you know, game plan. Mm-hmm. And then there's also the crying needs of the people at large that need jobs, healthcare, groceries, education, everything else. And public health crises really like raise these tensions to relief. And the university's right at the center of all of these tensions.
I'm sure, especially since, you know, the university is supposed to serve its local community. And so just quickly invite everyone, if you have any questions, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A below. I'll go ahead and ask a couple that we received beforehand. If you could just share a little bit about how many universities were in the U.S. at the time, and what was the average student and campus population size, just to get an idea of the overall, you know.
I was provided this question beforehand, and I've got the data. It didn't enter my notes for the call, but there's 500 colleges and universities that accept these SATC units. I will say that the average campus size of the top 10, top 20 universities around the country was much smaller than today, much smaller. So you're talking the average campus size was 20 to 25,000 at these Big Ten schools or Berkeley. Still big by modern standards, but not massive, like Ohio State or Florida or Arizona State. So, you know, you're looking at like at the high end, about 25,000 students. And to juice their statistics to make them look even bigger and heftier than they were, Schools like Berkeley and Michigan and Minnesota, Wisconsin, they used to also add in extension programs and summer studies, anything to make themselves look bigger. It was a really important value that universities strove for, was just to be as big as possible.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
And let's see. Oh, here's an interesting question. How did the 1918 pandemic affect the 1920s? I know you already mentioned that a lot of people tended, you know, tried to forget, and it wasn't necessarily published until the 70s, I believe, you know, the memoir. So how did this affect the 20s?
Yeah, I'm not going to quote Crosby. I want to, but I won't. But Alfred Crosby, in his 1976 book, America's Forgotten Pandemic, you know, his thesis is really apt. And because the flu was so time compressed, it blew through the country. It didn't even leave much of an economic mark. We would have had a recession in 1919 regardless because of the transition from a wartime to peacetime economy. And we did have a recession in 19, which led to the overwhelming electoral victory by Warren Harding in 1920, bringing the Republicans back into power after 8 years. Anthropologists, cultural anthropologists, and literary critics, and novelists, and historians, and everybody's had a bite at this question this year. What impact did the 1918 flu have on the 1920s? And they're using hindsight that I've never used before. My guess is that it led to it just fed into the nihilism of the Jazz Age. Live for today, because who knows what tomorrow will bring. But, you know, there's not a lot of solid evidence to show that the 1918 flu had any major impact on the 1920s. I want it to have had a major impact as a historian, because I'm kind of an expert in this particular period. But, you know, I can't say with any certainty that it did.
Yeah. And so if you were to take out your magic eight ball right now, how would you see this current pandemic affecting our 2020s and just this decade going forward?
Well, I feel like I'm on pretty solid ground as saying that it's going to make, you know, this generation feels, the young generation that's like, you know, in high school and college today feel both, ironically, both more anxious and also more confident. Because this really reinforces the fact that the future is hard to predict, but yet it's been the young generation in the United States that's shaken off whatever restrictions were placed on them by the public health elites, and they've carved out a new path that no public health officer would have been like, yeah, go do that, right? But they've taken the bull by the horns. And, you know, who knows what direction it's going to lead us, right? I think in very positive directions. But I think this generation is one that's always going to feel primed for leadership, because in these really important young years, formative years, you know, they've led. So I think the COVID-19 has given the young generation the opportunity to really lead. Now, 1918 is similar because, you know, veterans are coming back from the war, and the expression popped up, how do you put him back on the farm after he's seen Gay Paris? Because all these kids had been over to Europe and seen Paris. And we know that a lot of African-American veterans were treated much better in France by the French than they were in the United States by white Americans. And this made the Harlem Renaissance it gave it a real punch, because a lot of the veterans were saying, hey, you know, we deserve a lot better than this in our own country that we were getting in France. And so it had a major impact, at least on African-Americans. So, you know, you can guess for yourself how massively impactful the events of today might have for African-Americans throughout the 2020s. And I think for the whole, it should be, you know, massively positive.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned that. Okay, so before closing out, any final thoughts, Dr. Purdy?
Well, look, the alumni, I think the university often sleeps on the importance of alumni networks. You know, one of the main reasons I didn't mention about why the 1918 flu is kind of a forgotten historic episode, or was forgotten until recent years, is because of the 4-year cycle of undergraduate life. Undergraduates come in, they cycle out after 4 years for the most part, or they did back in 1918, and then their experiences go with them. They're kind of like portable experiences. But the importance of a public university, you really see it through the alumni networks. UCLA alums create UCLA, a UCLA that lasts beyond the 4 or 5 years of an undergraduate experience. Their understanding of what UCLA is and what it should be, that's what UCLA is. We're really built on this like foundation of memories and commitment from graduates, much more than any other population. Students come and go, faculty come and go, alums are there forever. They'll always have that UCLA degree. And they'll always carry with them their own understanding of what the university is supposed to be or what it can be. And this is a very powerful group of people.
I think so, yeah. And I feel like UCLA attracts a lot of high achievers. And even, you know, after graduation, these individuals are motivated to do more, to reconnect. I'm certainly thankful for our network. But thank you. I feel like that was a perfect leadway to this exit. Well, thank you, Dr. Purdy, for joining us today. I did want to share with everyone, this conversation sparked after I heard a podcast from Dr. Purdy called Purdy's Podcast, which will be, a link will also be sent out in the follow-up email. Thank you again, Dr. Purdy, for taking your time today to share with us more about the 1918 flu and how higher, you know, universities and UCLA specifically, how they responded. Thank you, Lauren, and the UCLA Alumni Association for hosting us and for, you know, holding this webinar. And I did again want to mention our upcoming event on July 2nd at 1 p.m. It's a Thursday. It's a home buyers panel where you'll learn more about the basics to home buying. If you have any ideas or any comments or feedbacks, please feel free to email me or find me on LinkedIn. Again, we're happy to take any feedback and create new programming to keep us all engaged during these really uncertain times. But again, thank you, Dr. Purdy, for your time. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today.